Aminata, and welcome back to our e-telecast, God Has a Word for You. And our theme is living faith. So what do you think? Is this not deep? Is this not deeper than deep? Did you find yourself like me, walking out of compliance with God's mandate that we ought to be living our lives by faith? Not by what I think, not by how I feel, not about what I experience, not by what somebody says. I don't care what the doctor say, what does faith say? I don't care what the lawyers say, what does faith say? That's the mandate that God has given to us. But listen to this, because we're going to go right into it, into the book of Hebrews. Hebrews 10:38 says this, "Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him." Ooh, ooh, ooh. Again, the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, and what that means is, and this is deep, this is something you need to pay attention to. It means that I start out trusting and believing God, and my faith is applied, and then somewhere along the line, I say, oh, you know what, I ain't got to wait on God. You know what, I don't have to depend on God. You know what, I'm going to handle this myself. God is saying, his soul will have no pleasure in you. Remember a couple sessions back, I said, you don't want to piss him off. This will do it, because of what it's saying, that you're going to kick God to the curb. Now, you know how it feels to be rejected. I don't think you want to reject God. And I don't think that you should allow anything that should ever happen to you, I don't care what the circumstances might be, to talk you into turning away from God. Mm-mm. If anything, it should make you run to him even more. There's even another part of this that's even more solemn. Because remember now, the just shall live by faith is a divine order. It's a mandate from God. This is not if I feel like it. This is what we better be doing. This is what we ought to be doing. But listen to this, and this is very serious. And it's scary. That's how serious it is. It is scary. So I want you to hear this. In the book of Exodus, Ezekiel 3 verse 20. "If good people turn bad and don't listen to my warning, they will die. If you did not warn them of the consequences, then they will die in their sins. Their previous good deeds won't help them, and I will hold you responsible, demanding your blood for theirs." If good people turn bad, all right, and if you don't warn them, what am I saying here? This is scary. I want you to pay attention. The conditions of our community, the state of our communities today, is because we as Christians are not doing what we're supposed to be doing. What am I saying? I am saying mother, I am saying father, I am saying that those are your kids in the school. Those are your kids that are giving the teachers hell. You need to go home and straighten out your home life. That's where your ministry is. That means you can no longer ignore the fact that your child may need some help. You cannot ignore the fact that, yes, your child is bad. You need to now get yourself together so that you can get your home life together. Mother and father. Yes, I am talking like that. It also means that there's a wife out there who has a husband that needs ministering to. You need to go and minister to your own husband. But I'm going to wait till Pastor Ken, you know, we're gonna cover that one. And then there's a husband that you need to start loving your wife and stop treating her like she's some kind of step stool. Now, I know some of you may be saying, I'm not the wife speaking like that. Because that's what the word is saying. It is saying that those of us who know, we better be giving out warning. Don't you think that this word is just for the pastor? It's for each and every one of us. And if anything, this should really shed some light on the fact that it's not good enough just to go to church on Sunday and sit in the pew. It's not good enough to go to church on Sunday and sing in the choir. It's not good enough to go to church on Sunday and be an usher. It's not good enough to play church. It's not. We must become the church, and we must follow His divine laws. And when you see it, you're supposed to address it in love, but you're supposed to address it. So many of us right now are trying to fake the funk. That's why it said to live means to enjoy the real life, because we're not living the real life. We're caught up in the world, and that ain't the real life. That's the temporal life. You know, God is the God and the maker of all that is, and look at all His beauty and all His glory, and we should be basking in it, and we shouldn't have to be worrying about anything or what anyone says other than what God says. And then we must do what He says, and we will reap the benefits. The just shall live by faith. That is a mandate. Don't worry. If you haven't gotten it right, it's okay. If you're hearing it now, it's okay. It's time to get it right. You know, I was like, oh, wow, Lord, you know. But He says, okay, because I'm growing you and I'm learning you. And that's the whole purpose of this. Aren't you happy? Somebody need to lift your hands and say, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He's given me another chance. He's giving you another chance to get it right. And the other thing is that we've got to reinstitute love in our life, genuine agape love, like my husband was talking about, to be Christ-like. You know, we've got to reinstitute that, and all that comes with my faith walk. The most ugliest people I've met are Christians. They got ugly hearts, cold hearts. I just had a conversation with a young lady a few weeks back. Beautiful young sister who says, let me tell you, I don't want to go to church because I don't want to deal with the people and their hatred and their hypocrisy. What could I tell her? She was wrong. But I told her, you know, I said, but you've got to learn how to look past them. But this is a woman who's seeking. God is not through with her yet. God is not through with you yet, because she's on the list as well. But she's right. The most cold-hearted, hateful people are in the church. And how do we demonstrate our faith like? How do we demonstrate our faith lives to the world if we're not using it? If we're not actualizing it, if we're not demonstrating it, you should be able to put a pep in your step when you go to work. Yeah, I know your supervisor got issues. That's right, but don't have the impact on you. Yeah. And don't be afraid to smile, because you got Jesus, and that's enough. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. See, that's what faith will give you. It'll give you everything you need to keep you going. Let me stop right here, because I'm just going on, and I got to come back. But until the next time, I'm Pastor Aminata. Hang with us. God has a word for you.
And yet accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, let's do so right now with this prayer of salvation. Pray after me, but it's more important that you believe it in your heart. Father God, I believe your word, and your word says that if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead, that I will be saved. So right now, I put my trust in you, Jesus Christ, as my personal Lord and Savior. I admit that I'm a sinner and that I need God in my life. So I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Amen. So if you prayed that prayer, I want you to drop us a line and email us and let us know. Because right now, you are saved and the angels in heaven are rejoicing. And do yourself a huge favor and find yourself a Bible-believing church and continue to grow in grace. God bless you.